This will be the protein horse, or the horse protein horse. And so we're going to feed our horse protein. In the mouth, we're going to have a decrease in particle size. In the stomach, we're going to have the addition of HCO, and we're going to have the addition of pepsinogen, or the secretion of pepsinogen, which is activated to pepsin. And by now you guys should know that that's HCl and pepsin that are capable of doing that. You might take a moment and think about the fact that this is going to be a relatively brief amount of time in the horse, because again, a smaller stomach, faster rate of passage. And what we're going to end up with is oligopeptides. And shorter peptides. And what we're going to do is draw the arrow all the way through. So just so you can see it, all the way through. Okay? And when the products of protein digestion from the stomach arrive at the small intestine, we have the SNI cells. They're going to produce or secretin. And they're going to secrete CCK. The cells will secrete CCK. And what this does is causes the secretion or the release of buffer from the small intestine to increase the pH of the small intestine to allow the enzymes to work for protein digestion. We're also going to get some buffer from the small intestine. And then the horse will produce pancreatic zymogens or zymogens. And by now, we should know all of those. And so we're not going to write them again. Maybe we'll write them, but we won't write the details. In their active form, that's going to look like trypsin, chymotrypsin, and carboxypeptidase A and B. We have enteropeptidase, which makes this activation happen, and horses again would be susceptible to trypsin inhibitor, or more so than the cow for sure, because they don't have fermentation prior to the small intestine. The other brushy border enzymes would be aminopeptidase, dipeptidyl aminopeptidase, and last but not least, tripeptidase. And the small intestine is where we're going to have the absorption of the products of protein digestion. So the products we have are amino acids, dipeptides, and tripeptides. They get absorbed. Refer back to the enterocyte or the cow if you're having problems with that. The amino acids that result, bidirectional transport to the blood. They go to the liver. And just like any other animal, deposit amino acids in tissue, whether that's a fetus or muscle. Use them for milk as well. For fetus and milk, they could mobilize their own body to allow that to grow. If they're fasting or getting an inadequate diet, they might take amino acids and use them as a source of energy. If they have excess amino acids, they can use those amino acids as a source of energy. I really like the way I drew that on the pig. And so we can take this excess amino acid, produce a carbon skeleton. That carbon skeleton, depending on what it is, could be used to create ATP. Also, if it's glucogenic or gluconeogenic, we could use that amino acid to create glucose, to synthesize glucose. We end up with an ammonia, and that ammonia can be used to synthesize another amino acid in the liver. That's where the non-essential amino acids can be synthesized, is using ammonia and a carbon skeleton. That takes place in the body. Urea can also be produced, which is excreted in the urine. And urea can be recycled back to the large intestine, where through the activity of microbial urease, it becomes ammonia. That ammonia can be absorbed and go to the liver. Where that ammonia can then be used to synthesize urea. Okay, when we get to the horse, this is large intestine. It's going to be more complicated, maybe not more complicated, but the importance or the extent of microbial utilization of nitrogen becomes greater. And so we're going to spend a little more time on that. But these processes, again, are happening in everybody's large intestine, just to a greater extent, probably, in the horses. So in the horse, we're going to introduce a more complete concept in that the protein that shows up in the large intestine could be feed protein, and it could be endogenous protein. Okay, an endogenous protein, we keep talking about cells and enzymes, glycoprotein, etc. Okay? And so when those show up, we're going to abbreviate this F+E. And so we can have F+E proteins. We can have F+E peptides. We can have F+E amino acids. And we can have F+E ammonia. And generally, the microbes are going to break this down to ammonia using microbial enzymes. And again, I can't reiterate this enough, this happens in the horse, in the cow, and in the pig, just to a greater extent in the horse. And what we end up with then is we have some ammonia. That ammonia is in the ammonia pool, which should seem really familiar because it's real similar to the rumen. This recycled nitrogen, recycled ammonia, can come here, and it can also go back the other way. So that ammonia pool is throughout the large intestine, so some of this ammonia could be absorbed, and some of this ammonia can be used in the synthesis of microbial amino acids here in a moment. As you guys should all remember, when we're doing this, we're producing a carbon skeleton. So when we're taking F and E amino acids, we're producing carbon skeleton. The microbe's getting ATP from that. That carbon skeleton is absorbed as a VFA, or can be absorbed as a VFA, and then go to the liver. The carbon skeleton can be used, so we can take this ammonia pool and we can make microbial amino acids. And that again is going to use a carbon skeleton and energy. Or we can break them down, and that is going to release a carbon skeleton and provide the microbe with energy. Okay, we can also synthesize microbial peptides. And then we can synthesize microbial protein. All of this requires ATP because we're synthesizing. And ultimately, this microbial protein becomes MCP, which is excreted in the feces. One thing that can happen right here is we can take F and E amino acids and use them directly to synthesize microbial amino acids. Thing that's happening here is we have some buffer being added. And remember, this is occurring in the pig, the horse, and the cow. Just the greatest extent would be in the horse. Okay, and something to really focus on, zoom out. Really to focus on, the advantage of being a horse when it comes to protein utilization is if we feed the horse a good source of amino acids, it's going to absorb those amino acids and use them itself. So if we gave them soybean meal, which would have a good amino acid profile, meaning it works well to meet amino acid requirements, the horse can absorb them directly and utilize them to meet its amino acid requirements, and then go on and break down the the feedstuffs that are more resistant to mammalian digestion, derive some value in terms of VFAs from that. The real limitation of being a horse or a pig in this case is if you feed them a poor quality source of amino acids, so amino acids that don't contain the correct ratio of essential amino acids, then the horse won't be able to meet its amino acid requirements. Whereas in the cow, we can feed them this poor source of amino acids, and the microbes will in the rumen will convert it to a high quality source of amino acids or a higher quality source of amino acids, allowing the animal to meet its protein requirements. Okay.